This is Jack Foley. The back cover of Kushal Potter's new book, A White Cane for the Blind Lane, describes the author in this way. Although Kushal Potter has authored 9 books, the latest being How to Burn Memories Using a Pocket Torch, and A White Cane for the Blind Lane is his 10th book, and while 2 books are published in India, 2 from Australia, 1 from Canada, the rest from the USA, and his works have been translated into 12 languages. And he has been a sub-editor of Outlook magazine and the editor of Word Surfacing, and he does some illustrations and sketches for various magazines. If you ask him, he will say that he gardens a growing-up daughter. Well, he gardens a good deal of poetry as well. And today's show will continue with my reading of poems from A White Cane for the Blind Lane by Kushal Potter. His last name is not, as a friend of mine thought, P-O-T-T-E-R, but P-O-D-D-A-R, Kushal Potter, K-U-S-H-A-L-P-O-D-D-A-R. And now, from A White Cane for the Blind Lane. Near the Embassy of the Songbirds. Near the Embassy of the Essenes, a cellist keeps his hat flipped on the street and his ears open for the music. From the attic of the edifice, a voice casts a red handkerchief. In the air, it is sunray. In the yard, it becomes a rose, the one drunken on the nightingale's blood. Late for my appointment with a feather, I run past the cellist, drop a lover's coin in his hat for good luck. Body. Yes. Did you enjoy? His eyes blade through her, and she bleeds. Silence. The pimp has 9 toes, a dance in his gait. The girl has pox-bitten cheeks. She makes a rat her pet. The room comes with a porcelain set no occupant ever used. The tale of a cup of poisoned tea shared with some client who found a heart where legs meet roams in the room like a vermin. That's called body. Follow the light. The examiner says, follow the light, please. The man closes his, and a summer dress flower garden replies to the wind by stirring. It is left on a blackened wood chair. Half of the house imagines its other half, gone half. Half of everything works full time. The wind burns. The crepitation forms an O around the site of another explosion nearby. He follows the light. Which period of time is this? It matters little. The halved room exists since someone discovered how to light up a fire. Buddha. A bird's chirping swirls out from sleep's echoskeleton. Haze and halo greet the room. The bard seems to say, Sakura. In this life, I've never seen a cherry blossom, not in person, albeit I know it is spring. My other lives are the garden ornaments, their hands hold invisible blessings. Reflections. That year, reflections, shadows and shades grasped my heart. I shivered, seeing shapes and light, not quite the opposite of it and what it co-creates with our flesh, its interpretations of us. This year, following the halo of our headlights on the pitch-black path, I wonder if heart died after a long convulsion. We throttle the gas. Even the glory they cast on the big screen doesn't make me feel anything. The red car, premium retro drive-in revival. Home videos of my mother back at home, or your kisses, all swirl, scatter, and fall like gray flakes. Insane self. Insane. If you call me, I'll agree. Not because of my soliloquies frequent in front of a ghost audience, and not because, provoked, I turn violent. Because I repeat my old defeats. I shall answer, desire to know about your children, and you will show anger because you have blue and gray at heart regarding that. Look at me, watching my dirty water, trembling twin. Look at that toenail, born and reborn, yellow between flesh and reflection. A wind touches your head, glad that madness is not airborne. You say, stay well. I see you go. I shall see you go again. A grave provocation. After a sudden friend's old death, we found it hard not to make love. Every dusk, returning home mid-work, as if that could cure gunshots, and the memories not bled because death didn't delay pushing through the cafe door. Death could have been late, kept the bullet for a day in May or thereafter, and found our by then best friend sad, with his love for both of us. He might not have any solution. Startled and relieved, desired to ask death, why are you so late? The cafe would have the same whiteout. Every New Year Eve. The bridge, not built to descend near the azure. Ferry boat, a flash of scales and of feathers. but it brings us to the cherry. I cross it every day, but the bridge behaves thus only once in a year. You ask me if I desire some caramel pop. And as usual, I want some savouries. Only on this eve, you become my father and flowing. The New Year Banner. Someone made the rock a god, progeny forgot. Near the tree's toes, the sun rolls. Last night is pale vomit. Sun rests its head on the rock. The New Year banner, taut while the young men held it high, flows free from the fists. You laugh, hoot, turn, and it is already gone. A cardiac cold myth. One guide once told a tourist that this heart attack water would cure all the diseases. And the old voyager believed. He froze his flesh and emerged fresh, reborn. It was a joke. It is a miracle. People come to this town for an ice water nighttime bath, and the guide is God. And this is good for economy. On the moonlit nights, one sees the commandments written in footprints. Snow's writing is as legible as a clear mind. After a fight with you, old friend, we... Still red, pungent and liquid, dusty and torn, ride the same homing tram. I would have offered a gasper to you as an offering to honor our conflict. But you cannot smoke here, and I no longer do. Night is darker in the part of the city we just left. We'll go to the part where night never comes, albeit we need some sleep, a dreamless slumber after a fight feels like water after something sour. The ego descends to the point it ceases to be homuncular and begins to seem colossus. The ground I stand is the white eye of the halo of the bird's dark orbit. The last day flies away. The ground looks disconcert at its sudden broadness, and I have time's topography and no destination. In duotone, I watch a social influencer preaching. Do not wear black, the color of rejection. My father's black, one my mother. She was proud of my light skin. But then again, she loved beaches, hated water. My skin is so light that it flies around in the kitchen sometimes. My pungent substance makes all cry. Some days one cannot embrace rejection. It's in duotone. Argentium, mode of silver. You part the curtains, and the silver flakes on the floor remind me of my mother's faith in silver as a cure for the evil in one's blood or soul. She kept a vial of argentium handy. She believed in homeopathy as well. What time is it? You answer, of memories. Despite my careful first step, I slip on the shining substance, intangible. My mother's plasma, unreal. And I fall into another room, the one within, and scream for help. The silhouette of a portly woman arranging memento mori in a glass vase does not turn or hear. Inside out. Inch by inch, the domiciliary plant scurries towards the window. Its leaves know it is morning now. The room doesn't mind its darkness until it gawks at the steps, yards, fence, and beyond through the gape in the wall. I set my mother upright. Tell her, imagination is the first art of rebellion. Loose yourself. It will be a relief. The room leaps outside like a flipped inside-out pocket. That's inside-out. I should mention, we're more than halfway through the show, this is Jack Foley, and I'm reading from Kushal Potter's new book, A White Cane for the Blind Lane. They're wonderful poems, surreal, obviously. And it's Kushal, K-U-S-H-A-L, and Potter, P-O-D-D-A-R. A friend of mine thought it was Potter, you know, but it isn't that. It's Potter. It's Indian, P-O-D-D. AR, East Asian, I should say. Museum of Shadows. 1 year ago, you availed some scissors to censor your tongue, burned down the tree you buried your clapper underneath. Evening was a nursery of noises. They susurrated the synonyms of your sins. I still visit you, you, sedated, follow the shadows we cast. We have so many shades that we should make a museum of those. That's Museum of Shadows. One of the interesting things about Kushal's work is it's not quite the kind of English one would expect an American poet to be writing, but he's not an American poet. He's from India. And while it is still English, it is has a different flavor. It has a different quality from anything you're likely to hear from someone in the United States. I'm not sure that it's been through William Carlos Williams, but it's certainly powerful and interesting. I have to ask him sometime whether he has read Williams, who is trying to come as close to speech as possible. I don't think Kuschel is trying to do that. He's not trying to move away from speech. He makes assertions all the time, and they're clear assertions, even though we don't know what they mean, because they frequently have elements in them that seem to contradict what the sentence is saying. This is Black Monk. Night plays with the outer walls. Black acts rebellious, defies gravity's reign. The monks who fed us a dozen oranges pray in far side dormitory. Hearing is holy. Forgetting doesn't mean walking away from a memory. I step into the sleep's garden, write your names with pebbles, all small letters, and realize that instead of a name, it is a long sentence. This next one is called Remember Nirvana? Never mind. The child resurfaces. The morning has no color yet. Some smoke signals sketch a message of constant and calm distress. A neighbor sees the child first. It toddles, skids, and falls on the dew-wet street. The child cannot say anything about the time eclipsed. Time, a mystery. And the time the parents dream as a body of blue fluids. The child swims until a ransom baits it out. This is a longer one. It's called Hiraeth Heart. And Hiraeth, or Hiraeth, is a Welsh word that has no direct English translation. The University of Wales likens it to homesickness tinged with grief and sadness over the lost or departed. Hiraeth Heart. Nothing, in sooth, changes. Nothing does. The shapes and shades, though, may differ a dash. Mine is the azure hue, shades in its neighborhood and apart, jotted in the dirt, you know, in the matter of dream and heart. Eyes shut, I see someone saunters, and the water shivers as if the fever it runs has climbed up a stiff ridge. Again, I see this. This again, wherever you go. The same narrative depicts this life with a few pen throughs. Two. The canal, tree, one falcon between the blinks. For no reason, I stare lock a muddy cigarette butt thrown away by some stranger here. Three. What are you starting at? An abstract says my father, standing in our yard without his glasses, with his narrowing vision. Everything is a soul, fleshless, out of focus. 4. The tweet draws my attention to one bird, and now my eyes and my mind are that bird, one and single, and nilch, and an egg, and a fledgling too shy to fly for the first time or the last. 5. A parcel of birds and a sycamore seeks morning's crisp air, and at first nothing else ants its way into my brain. Nothing, no thought bearing the buzz of money, health, or weather. Then one red bus speeds past our pro tem shelter by the broad bad road, reminding everything in crazy waves. 6. Forgive the parrot. It vomits the word lumps human fed it. Forgive it for cussing and narrating the tales from the back of the household coop. I leave a lean and soggy green chili at the parrot's place. Sadness levitates the veg. It floats between two kinds of gravity. 7. Two tired girls lower their bundles of firewood and pitchers of water to rest near the slope of the dry canal. The odor of rot bothers them not, and they fold their knees as if they are synchronized. They do not know death sniffs their ankles, but scurries away without biting. Well, the poem goes on, and you can see it's a kind of wonderfully interesting, wonderfully mad speech that is the poetry of Kushal Potter. All of these things resonate with one another. They don't necessarily connect logically, but they have a emotional connection of one sort or another. We don't always know exactly what he's talking about, and yet we feel what's there as we read it word by word, and the words tell us. This, again, it's Jack Foley, and I've been reading from Kushal Potter's book, A White Cane for the Blind Lane. Thanks for listening.
Community Powered speaks to KPFA's 75 years of building lasting relationships with you. At KPFA, our mission is connecting with like-minded listeners under the umbrella of neighbors, breaking down the walls of indifference. Through storytelling for social change, we reach back into our shared past of migration, violence, segregation, and inequality that has stunted America's growth. Yet together, and only together, supporting each other's good work through action and commitment, we can make positive change. We need your support for KPFA to continue to be a thought leader, a connector, and a driver of high-level engagement. We've been building community trust since 1949. Demonstrate your support today for 94.1 FM at kpfa.org. Thank you.
The following program is pre-recorded. Good afternoon and welcome to Cover Cover Jovelyn's Bistro. I am your host. Happy Wednesday to you. Today I will be talking with Joe Geis. Joe Geis is an award-winning radio journalist, author, teacher, community activist, and former TV reporter. As a special correspondent, she was part of the Peabody Award-winning team at Marketplace, the most popular business program in America. At Marketplace, she won an Emmy for an exceptional radio story from the National Women's Political Caucus and a Gracie from the Foundation of American Women in Radio. She's traveled all over the world, and today Jo will join us to talk about her memoirs, Never Sit If You Can Dance, Lessons from My Mother Babe. Welcome, Jo, to Cover to Cover with Jovelyn.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
It's good to have you. So you have written this lovely memoir of growing up with Babe, and in that you are offering your reader many gifts of lessons that Babe taught you that stayed with your life and gave you a wonderful life in many ways, and offerings to other people that you met in your own journey.
Excuse me? Was that a question?
Yes, it's a question. It's a comment that what your book is offering as a gift, that these lessons that you learned from your mother is the gifts that you were able to offer people in your own journey.
Yeah, I look at it that way, that that people will, I think that's at the end, that's the last sentence at the end of the introduction, that it says that I wrote this collection as a gift for Babe and for all the mothers everywhere who laid the groundwork that shaped us, even if we didn't exactly recognize it or appreciate it or them at the time. Babe gave me these gifts, and in this book, I'm giving them to you, the reader.
Exactly. So tell us about the book. Tell us about your mom and growing up with Babe.
Well, I think one thing about that I've heard from other people about the book is that, so why your mother? What's so special about your mother? You know, why not my mother or somebody else's mother? And at first when I heard that from people, I kind of went, well, okay, you know, I had to think about it. And then what I thought about is that Mom, first of all, she was named Gladys, but she didn't like that name, and she was the baby in the family, so they called her Babe, and it stuck with her, and she was some babe. She was just much more lively and with it than almost any of the other mothers I knew. And this was the title of the book is something that she said, you know, never sit if you can dance. But what she meant by that, and she and my father danced a lot all the time, but what she really meant by that is not just dance, because some people are intimidated by the idea, well, I don't know how to do the two-step or I don't know how to do the tango. What do you mean dance? I'm just going to sit here. What she meant is just get up off your tush and move. And I like that philosophy a lot.
So when you talk about your mom in the early part of your book and you share that she went along with her father on his trips as when he worked, his job requirement, he was an engineer, but not a formal engineer, but he had the skills, the trades of that, and he would travel in his work, and your mom would go with him, and she would wait for him in the car, and you resisted that kind of personality that you later learned to appreciate, if I have that
correct. Well, what I really rebelled against at the time is that when she was waiting for him in the parking lots on these road trips that they went on, is she was embroidering. And I just thought that was so docile and passive and, you know, stitch after stitch. I mean, my dad was in there at a business meeting. He was an inventor, and he invented equipment that revolutionized shipyards. And in the beginning, he was his own salesperson, too. So he's in there at this business meeting, and sometimes I got to tag along with them. I don't know why they let me. I can't have been that much of a pleasure, maybe. And Mom is outside with her needles and her embroidery thread. I just thought she should be doing something a little more important than that. But, see, this is what is interesting, I think, if you live long enough to see kind of the arc of people's lives. When I asked her about that not too long ago, I said, hey, Mom, what were you doing, on those trips out there just stitching? I mean, I still have those dish towels and pillowcases she did. And she said, well, I was supporting your dad. When he came out of a meeting, like at Todd's shipyard, and things hadn't gone so well, he had someone to talk to about that. Or if things had gone really well, he had someone to celebrate with. And I didn't, little scoldy 8-year-old at the time, when I looked down at her just hanging around in the industrial parking lots embroidering, I didn't realize that what she was really doing was contributing to their marriage and strengthening their marriage. And then I thought, oh, wow, right, because she really adored my dad, and she was crazy about him. And I think I inherited that kind of feeling about my husband from how she was with Dad. I mean, they had a real love affair.
In your conversations with your mom, Joe, did you ever discover, like, a part of what made her so different? Like, what happened? And was it just something innate in her that she didn't go with the pack? Like, for instance, when you speak to other women who have mothers, or the mothers that you grew up with around the circle of people, your mom stood out, had her own way of moving through, navigating the world. Did you ever talk to her about where that came from, her independence in a world in which at that time you didn't see her necessarily as being independent, but she was a very independent woman in what she wanted to do and how she did her life?
You know, that's an interesting question. I'm not sure how I would answer that. Why she was so, she even married somebody who was an inventor. And one of her sisters married someone who worked in a shipyard. He unloaded ships. And another of her sisters married a carpenter. So she had a different feeling about herself from early on, I think. I'm not really sure about that.
Do you think that some of that has showed itself in your own life personally, where you've found that you actually have walked your own path when the rest of the world around you, colleagues, etc., had their own way of doing something, but yet there was something in you that was comfortable with resisting, if that may be the right word, but doing you? Have you discovered that part of her in you?
Yeah, that's a really good comment. And some of that also comes from my dad, mm-hmm. who was an inventor, a self-trained engineer, and he always told me that boss is a four-letter word. Don't ever have a boss. And as a journalist, sometimes that was a hard, that wasn't the best advice, maybe. So they were a team in that. They both put together a pretty creative lifestyle for the times that they were, growing up in the 40s and 50s and 60s.
You're listening to Joe Guys here on Cover to Cover with Jovelyn Richards. So, Joe, you also took up dancing because of your parents, which was an important part of their life and their social circle. And in fact, one of your divorces, you went immediately to dance class.
Oh, wait, I only had one divorce.
One divorce. Oh, that's right, Joe. Yeah. Well, your husband passed away, your divorce, absolutely.
Right.
But you found that it was dance that really was part of your healing process.
Oh, absolutely. I went out, I did line dancing, and then I did, at the time it was called Fumbling Toward Ecstasy with Five Rhythms, where you just, it's kind of like trance dancing. And I even actually brought my mother to some of the Fumbling Toward Ecstasy to see if she, I didn't think at that point. At that point she was in her late 80s, and I didn't think she was going to do the dancing. I didn't think she's going to fumble around, but she wasn't judgmental about it at all. It's a kind of trance dancing where men are often wearing long skirts, women are wearing, you know, anything goes, and it was certainly a way I ended up healing myself, and I would turn to dancing. I didn't turn to, formal dancing like, you know, football, step, turn. I did some of that once. I signed up, I think he's called Dr. Dance, and I signed up for some classes, and it was just too regimented for me. I like free-form dancing. And what's really kind of fun with the book, Never Sit If You Can Dance, which, by the way, even though it's not coming out until Mother's Day, you can pre-order on Amazon now. But what's fun about it is it's not, we're just talking about movement. We're not talking about that you've got to be intimidated that somebody is better than you are at something.
Tell us some of the lessons that your mom offered you, that, and you also, as you said earlier when we started our interview, that you're offering others to be able to take a look at. Lesson, you have 13 lessons inside of the contents. Tell us about some of the lessons that, and not just some of them, but ones that you have found really valuable for your own life.
Well, I love them all, of course, but because I think there's a surprise in many of them. But one of my favorite ones is don't be drab. Her idea her way of expressing herself, I remember this when she was pregnant with my sister, who is 9 years younger than I am. So I was 9 years old at the time. And my mother had a maternity dress in. They wore maternity dresses in rather than tight T-shirts. It was red, and it had pleats. It came all the way down from the neckline to the hemline, and it was just this cascade of red pleats and with a bow at the neck. And that pretty much summed up Babe. She was never going to be drab. And when she was not, when you go by those stores, you know, and all they have a clothing in there that's gray and black, and there's not even any splash of red or any color at all, she would have just walked by those, because it wasn't that she was wearing color to make herself that attractive, although she certainly believed in being attractive, but it was more about that color also attracted people to her, sort of like, let's be friends. And I notice that when I go out and I'm wearing something red or something orange, red is my favorite color, people will say, wow, you know, that looks cheerful. And I think it's really helpful. There was just this wonderful piece about Abraham Lincoln a little bit ago in the Wall Street Journal, and it showed him wearing a red vest. And I thought, right, and it was a bright red vest. He had on this kind of dull brown jacket, probably with leather on the elbows, but he had this cool red vest on underneath it. And I thought, right on, you know, Mom would have approved.
You, in terms of the lesson 9, people don't like to be around depressed people. And this came up out of a saying that your mom had. She was depressed, but there was also a saying that a poster that said, "I can't make it alone." And you at the time was expressing your independent feminism. What is that lesson that you learned from that and your mom taught you?
Well, my mom would just, I was kind of the typical New Yorker back then. I was living in New York City. If you didn't have your own therapist at the time, everybody had their own therapist to, you know, help them through their depression. And but I looked at my mom, who, when I was growing up, had all these miscarriages, and she was depressed during that period. But then she, after she got over that, she just kind of sucked it in and just said, people don't like to be around depressed people. And so this was another of the lessons, lesson 5, make the best of it. And okay, I'll tell you a story about that. And in the book, it's stories about getting stuck in the middle of nowhere because my father had a job in this dam in the middle of nowhere in Montana. And some other wives and mothers would have just, you know, stayed home with the kids and let the dad go off for the summer. But she found a shack, literally a shack, and fixed it up. And we went and lived there. But I was thinking about this recently because I think I told you that I tore my Achilles tendon, and I had a very bad time in the recovery. It's going on 63 days now. But it was a couple weeks ago, and a very good friend of mine who knows my book well said, okay, because I was kind of down in the dumps because I wasn't walking yet. My friend said, okay, what would Babe say? And what would her lesson for you be in this? And she would say, make the best of it. And I thought, okay. So my husband threw me a birthday party with cakes and champagne, and the house was filled with friends and love, and it cheered me up. And I think she just had, even when, like, I mean, there's so many great stories, but one, when Hurricane Carla was fixing to smash into Houston, it smashed in, unfortunately, to Galveston instead. But, and my mother thought that, you know, they were going to evacuate, and the neighbor came over with her 5 kids and the bird in the cage, and Mom realized that the neighbor knew nothing more about evacuating than she did, so they all stayed put. But they got all the food together. Everybody rounded up at my parents' house, and it's one of the, like, best memories of my childhood because it was about gathering together and friendship and communities, and, you know, this hurricane is threatening to, you know, hit, but we were still all together and celebrating and eating the food, sharing the food we had. And my mom was really a master at that. She just knew how to gather people together.
And never leave a compliment unsaid. Lesson 11. Tell us about that one, because I mentioned that one in this moment because I think women have a hard time embracing compliments and living inside of them and empowering themselves.
And, well, that,
yeah.
Well, you have chosen out the only lesson in the book that I learned from my mother backwards, that I did exactly the opposite of what she did. You know, sometimes mother doesn't know best. And because growing up, she never gave me a compliment. And she said, even when I would come back from a speech tournament and had won all the trophies, And she said, well, it would go to my head. I would get conceited. And she, there were three of us kids, and she said she didn't want to just compliment one of us. But as a good friend of mine said, when she heard that story, she said, yeah, but she could have given all three of you compliments. But, and maybe it was also that kind of modest 50s parenting that that you don't go overboard with compliments like that. But, and so what I've done in my life, since I know how good it feels to get a compliment, I give them if they even slightly occur to me, like if I see somebody in a yellow dress and I happen to love that color, if it occurs to me that, boy, she looks great in that, I mean, even if it's a total stranger and I don't know her, actually, that's one of the stories in the book. I was in a store, a bookstore, and this woman had on this very cheerful yellow dress. It was almost springtime, and I said, wow, isn't that a cool color you've got on? It's one of my favorites. And she said, oh, she said, I'm so glad you said that. She said that she'd just been at a funeral, and her girlfriends were all berating her for wearing that color to a funeral, and she said she thought the person who had died would appreciate it, and she was actually had tears in her eyes when she thanked me for the compliment. And I have found that frequently, that I'll give people a compliment just out of the blue, and it touches them so so profoundly. I think that's something that maybe we can all learn even more, that if any positive feeling we have about someone else, if we think that, like the barrister at the coffee shop had on a really cool plaid tie, and I said, you know, you look great in that tie, and he did, and then he told me he really liked, like, my Harry Potter black glasses, and I said, oh, thanks, yeah. You know, and so we both went on our way with a little bounce in our step. We weren't flirting. We weren't hitting on each other. We were just passing on some positive vibes. And I just love that.
How do you think, Jill, that what you have written, Never Sit If You Can Dance, at this time in history where the story, the narrative that's out there is that there's a level of division between people more heightened with the political and economical ties we exist in. How do you imagine some of the lessons that your mom, Babe, passed on to you could really come into people's lives that read your work, your memoirs, and offer them tools to be able to navigate?
You know, that's a good comment, in that I think that in these turbulent, coarse, uncivil times, that I've heard that people who've read my book say that it offers a lesson in decent civility. I mean, we're not talking Emily Post, like what fork you should use. We're talking about how to treat each other with more kindness and respect. And look, you know, come on. I came from this, you know, through the back door here. I mean, I was the original scoldy daughter, put-down artist. I was, you know, flying off to New York to be a journalist. I didn't respect what my mother was doing when I was a kid. I thought she should be, I don't know, I had this idea she should be a judge. I didn't even know what a judge was. I think I made the point that in these turbulent times, that
Decency. What I'm hearing you say is a common decency, just some of the accessible tools that we have, like saying to a person that yellow color looks wonderful on you, to a stranger, saying to a person that what you just did, I like that. It just, and as you've seen how people respond, I think we all in this moment can remember a time when someone that without a name or address to them that we know of have said something and it sort of said, wow. Acknowledgement. And then lesson 13, sometimes life begins again at 95.
Well, this is, I was recently asked, like, what's my favorite lesson in the book? And I thought, oh, well, it probably will be sharing fun is the whole thing, or maybe never showing up empty-handed. I really like that one. But what really came to me kind of out of the blue was sometimes life begins again at 95. And I almost choke up even thinking about it, because my mother had been living pretty independently, and then she got shingles. That was really about the only thing she ever got. But then she lived with me for a while, and she lived with my sister. And it became apparent that that a senior community might be a good answer for her at this last part of her life. And I think my sister and I and my brother, we had, you know, some misfeelings about this, maybe some guilt about it, maybe we should do something. Anyway, my sister found this wonderful senior community in Houston, and it didn't look idyllic. It was a 16-story building. That's not necessarily what you think of. Maybe like a parkland or something you'd think of. But the people there were wonderful. And what had been missing previously when she'd been living like at my sister's was this camaraderie of her peers. And she got in with a group there, like eight of them ate their meals together. And she had people knocking on her door all the time. And she just blossomed. And I have also heard and I have read Atul Gawande in his book Being Mortal. He talks about this phenomenon that he witnessed with his father, that at a certain age, people can blossom in the right environment.
And that's the lesson that I want everyone to hear. We've come to the end of our conversation. You've been listening to Joe Geis, Never Sit If You Can Dance, Lessons from My Mother, Babe. Thank you, Joe.
Oh, thank you.
Bye-bye.
On the first Friday of each month, KPFA will provide music at the First Friday Block Party at the Donkey and Goat Winery. This event features local artisans and rotating food pop-ups. The monthly gathering with the community happens in the Donkey and Goat's dreamy Berkeley backyard. The block party goes from 3 to 8 p.m. Music is provided by KPFA DJ Mike Biggs and a special guest monthly rotating guest DJ. Donkey and Goat is located at 1340 5th Street off of Gilman in Berkeley. This is a wheelchair accessible event.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.